going out of bounds if you don't or can't check for it, or if your hardware doesn't signal it to you, can be really, really embarrassing, because all sorts of dangerous situations can happen. Perhaps the most easy one to understand is that, yes, if you add together two positive numbers that are too big, they're going to come out looking like a negative number. The overflow situation will propagate into the sign bit. You add together two things which have got a zero on the left saying clearly they're positive, and when the whole thing overflows, you end up with the answer having a one in the sign bit, so it's looking negative. If you, for example, had a digital radio altimeter which was absolutely sure that you were at 30,000 feet, and then suddenly found that it had run out of bits, and oh dear, you've added together the latest increment in height because you've climbed a bit, and oh dear, you seem to be 60 fathoms deep under the sea. Things can get very, very embarrassing indeed if other hardware that controls your engine or your flaps relies absolutely on this thing being correct. I'm going to describe to you in three different ways how you might tackle doing negative numbers. Whichever notation you use, it turns out to be handy to keep the right-hand side of your bit pattern as you look at it for the actual magnitude of the number, and save the leftmost bit as you're looking at it for denoting the sign. And almost universally it will be, if that so-called sign bit, as it's now called, is zero, then it denotes a positive number. If it's a one, it's going to denote a negative number. So roughly speaking, if you think about that, 0 and 1 signalling the sign, that leaves you 3 bits left for the actual size of the number, be it positive or negative. Well, in 3 bits you can hold anything from 0 to 7. So roughly what one is saying is that if we have a range of numbers that goes from plus 7 to minus 7, if you think about it, that's 14 different numbers. 1 to 7 positive, 1 to 7 negative, 14 different numbers. But in 4 bits, we can accommodate 16 numbers. 2 to the power of 4 is 16. 0 to 15 in unsigned. So where's the other two gone? We've allocated 14, there's two more. The other two are real trouble causers, because what tends to happen in your naive approach to this, which we'll do in a minute, is that those two missing numbers converge on wanting to be zero. So you end up with plus zero and minus zero, and that is a pain. You start off with zero, four zeros here for plus zero. If you put a one in the sign bit position but leave the others to zero, then of course you've got minus zero. What could be more nightmarish if you're trying to design a binary adder circuit to say, oh, we've not just got to check for plus zero, we've got to check for minus zero. Okay, and all the rest just follow exactly like that. Look, 0, 0, 0, 1 is plus 1, so what would minus 1 be? Same as plus 1, not 1, but put a 1 to denote negative at the left-hand side. And that works all the way in this sign and magnitude notation. The example I'm going to take in all three of these notations I'll be covering is just simply this. Plus 7 and add on minus 3 to it. In other words, it's 7 take away 3, the answer's got to be 4. Now where do we get to with sign and magnitude? We write down plus 7. Then we write down 1, 0, 1, 1. Don't forget, this is now the sign bit. It's special. The 0, 1, 1, 2 and a 1 is 3. But the 1 in the sign bit position says, I'm trying to do 7 minus 3. Your hardware man then starts saying, look, I've got to build some binary logic circuitry to do this. And what I want is just to do simple binary additions with carries. Even though it's a subtraction, I don't care. You've told me you've denoted a negative number. I want to do simple binary additions of ones and noughts, and I want the answer to drop out just magically to being plus 4. Will it? Not a chance. I'm going to say, if you just add them, what would happen? You get 1 plus 1 is 0 and carry 1. 1 and 1 and 1, we now know you put down a 1 and you carry a 1. 1 plus 1 is 0, but it carries a bit over into this sign bit column. Oh, what a nightmare! What it's trying to tell you, look, is that the answer's 2. It isn't. When you come to analyse this carefully, it happens largely because the sign bit is not actually part of the number. It's an add-on extra. So this one, I think we can throw right out the window and say it may appeal to you as a human to do it like this, but really that is not going to be easy to build hardware around. What you want actually, in some sense, is to map those negative numbers differently. In other words, you map them top down from the big numbers down to the little ones in terms of what an unsigned number would be, do them the other way around, and it all is so much easier. What one's complement does is it says form the negative number by taking the positive one and inverting every bit. If it's a zero, turn it to a one. If it's a one, turn it to a zero. What that does is it turns zero into being what would have been 15 in unsigned, yeah? But, since one on the left is signed, now means it's a negative number, you still have the two representations of zero problem. You've got zero and you've got minus zero. However, look what happens here. You map 0001. You flip all the bits, this is a rule to make it negative, change 0001 into being 1110. So that is how you do minus 1. But what does 1110 mean if it were an unsigned number? It means 8 plus 4 plus 2, it's 14. So I've mapped minus 1 into being 14. I've mapped minus 2 into being 13. This is what I mean by coming downwards, okay? Now, if you do that, well, you're part way on the way to getting a system in which the sign bit behaves almost normally, and that's what you want to do. Let us note, let me say yet again, this still has the problem of two representations of zero, which hardware and software people would absolutely hate. Could you imagine in your Java program if you wrote if I equals equals zero, and behind the scenes a swearing compiler indulges in lots of bad language saying, owing to the architecture of this machine, I've now got to check for plus zero and minus zero. Don't want that. You want one representation of zero. Anyway, for the moment, this is a step on the way. We're getting there. This is one's complement. And let's do our thing of taking plus 7 and adding minus 3. Well, since 7's a positive number, that is still 0, 1, 1, 1. But we've now got to add in minus 3. Well, we look up what minus 3 is in 1's complement, and it is 1, 1, 0, 0. Now, what I'm saying is that is a positive representation because it's got naught there, that's plus 7. This is a negative number, clearly it is. It's got 1 in the sign bit position. Let's just add them together. 1 and 0 is 1. 1 and 0 is 1. 1 and 1 is 0 but carry 1. 1 and 1 is 0. This is in the sign bit position now, but we're still treating it now like it's an ordinary binary pair of integers. But I've still got 1 plus 1 is 0, and it will generate a carry. The rule in 1's complement arithmetic says the following. Treat the sign bit just like a normal binary addition in that position. But if you generate a carry out from the sign bit, don't throw it away, don't ignore it. Just bring it back on a journey round to the right-hand end of the number and add it in. So we then have 0, 0, 1, 1 plus 1. 1 and 1 is 0, carry 1. 1 and 1 is 0, carry 1. 1 and 0 is 1. 0 and 0 is 0. Yippee! That's plus 4. That's the right answer. Now you might say, oh well, bringing around that carry bit, it's just black magic. Yeah, that would need a more advanced tutorial explaining exactly why. But it really does work. It's simply this. It says, just treat the sign bit as normal. Don't get panicked about it. If you do generate the carry bit, just bring it round to the right-hand end and add it back in. Okay, so we're making real progress now. We've got something which does give us the right answer, but you have to mess about with carry bits a little bit. Wouldn't it be nice if we could get rid of that effect, not have to worry about any carry bits, and also what we really want to solve is this, we don't want two zeros, okay? Now, there is a big problem here, because if you think about it, you've got 7 positive numbers, 7 negative numbers, you've got 2 left over. If you don't have 2 zeros, and you only want 1 zero, what's going to happen to that 16th number? As we'll find out now in the final phase of this story, your leftover number has either got to become an extra positive number or an extra negative number. So we'll now do 2's complement. 2's complement is equivalent to the 1's complement with 1 added to it. Let's just take a sample middle of the range number, plus 3. Let's turn it into 2's complement. And remember, what you do to do that is you take the binary representation of 3, you first of all turn it into 1's complement by flipping the bits, and then you add 1. Let us take plus 3, this is 0, 0, 1, 1. And we want minus 3 in, well, first of all, we do minus 3 in 1's complement. Easy, you just flip the bits. You go 1, 1, 0, 0. And in 2's complement, what do? You take the 1's complement, which you've already got, and you add 1. And you see what happens. 1 plus 0 is 1, 0, 1, 1. There's your answer. So minus 3 in 2's complement is represented by 1, 1, 0, 1. In unsigned terms, this is now being represented by 13, 1, 1, 0, 1. Whereas in 1's complement terms, it was 1, 1, 0, 0. It was represented by 12. So we've shoved the whole range down by 1. Believe it or not, that now magically gets rid of the 2 zeros problem, just by shifting the range. And if you like, this is the fundamental piece of magic, which I think we can do over here. Just consider 0, 0, 0, 0, plus 0. I'm now going to turn it into minus 0, and with trepidation, because it's probably going to be some other completely different bit pattern. But just look what the rule says. It says, do the 1's complement first of all. 1, 1, 1, 1. And add 1, because 2's complement is 1's complement plus 1. Look what happens now. 1 and 1 is 0, carry 1. 1 and 1 is 0, carry 1. 1 and 1 is 0, carry 1. 1 and 1, we're in the side bit position, but we don't panic, it's just like any other. 1 and 1 is 0, and we carry 1. Oh, I've got to do an end around carry. No. The thing you have to remember in 2's complement is that carries at the left hand end are just thrown away and ignored. They do not do an end around carry like they did in 1's complement. This is magic. You just throw the carry bit away. And what are you left with? Naught, 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 naught. Look at that. Plus 0 has mapped into looking like plus 0 when you take its 2's complement negative. That's exactly what you are after. It's one representation of 0, and only 1. But you'll now say, oh, now come on, you warned us that if you have only 1 0, and you if you have an 1 to 7, that's 7 numbers, and minus 1 to minus 7, another 7 numbers. You've only got 1 0. That's only 15 slots taken up. What's happening to the 16th slot? Although it's a 4-bit system, it now ranges from 0 to 7 in positive, but in negative numbers, there's the 0 appearing again, but right down the bottom, 1 and 3 zeros. What does that one represent then? And the answer is minus 8.
What happens when it goes wrong?
Well, we've discovered, of course, that in 2's complement 4-bit representation, we can go from minus 8 up to plus 7. You add anything within those ranges, as we've been doing, like 7 plus minus 3, there's no problem. The answer's going to be in range, obviously. But if you add together, shall we say, plus 7 to plus 7, then that's plus 14, and that's too big positive to be held in 4 bits. Equally, if you add, I don't know, minus 5 to minus 5, that comes to minus 10. And we can go down as far as minus 8, but not minus 10. So how does this show up then? We're clearly going to get overflows. Well, I think the answer is, if you look back or think back in the video to what we were doing when we were carefully adding 7 to minus 3 and staying in range, What I didn't point out, but perhaps should have done at the time, is that the carry bit that appeared on the left, do you remember? You carried out of the sign position. I said, oh, it's too competent, you can throw it away. Yes, you can throw it away. But what you would find is, if it's gone wrong, is that there was a carry in to the sign bit before there was a carry out. And the rule, very simply, is this, is if the carry in to the sign bit and the carry out to the sign bit are the same sort of thing, like you carry in a one, you carry out a one, that's fine. Or you carry in a nought, you carry out a nought, that's fine. But if they're the opposite way around, a nought gets carried into the sign bit, a one gets carried out, or a one gets carried in and a nought gets carried out, surefire sign of overflow. And that is exactly what the hardware engineer wants. They don't want to have to start thinking about the magnitude of the numbers. They want a simple rule about carry bits which says it's overflowed. And then you set a hardware overflow indicator, just like that. This is a problem. It hit us and would have embarrassed us slightly in the Ackerman function video, because those counters we were setting for all the big integers we were doing were overflowing all the time. We just weren't checking for it.